It's our privilege this week, for those of you who were not here yesterday, to have a dear friend, Dr. Dennis Rainey, who is the president and CEO of Family Life Ministry. It's a subsidiary of CRU, or Campus Crusade for Christ, as some of you know. Since the organization began in 1976, Dennis' leadership has enabled Family Life to grow into a dynamic and a vital ministry that offers families blueprints for living godly lives. He's authored or co-authored more than two dozen books, including best-selling Moments Together for Couples and Staying Close. He can be heard on a daily broadcast as a co-host of the Family Life Today. For his work in radio, he's been honored a couple of times with the National Religious Broadcasters Radio Program of the Year. He serves on the board of the directors of Family Life, but he also serves on our board and comes in at least twice a year to contribute to leadership, direction, and protection of Dallas Theological Seminary. And he, I can tell you as a president, is a consummate board member of counsel, of encouragement. We've gone on his turf and sat with him, Dr. Yarbrough and myself, to gain questions and insight as we strategically think about the future. He's been in meetings on our campus, and we deeply appreciate, Dennis, your input to us at the board level as well as a friend. He has a degree in business administration from the University of Arkansas. He has been honored with the Doctorate of Divinity from Trinity Evangelical Theological School in Deerfield, Illinois. He's been married to his wife, Barbara, and they've been married since 1972. That's when I married my wife, Barbara. He has an assistant named Michelle in his office. I have an administrative assistant named Michelle in my office. I have two boys. He has six children. I have five grandchildren, and he has 21. 21. It's the difference between two and six in the second generation. Dennis, thank you for carving out time for preparing and planning. Would you join me in welcoming Dennis Rainey?
You're a good man. Well, it is good to be here. This has been a treat. And I told you I brought some resources with me that I'm going to give away. For those of you who weren't here yesterday, we had a fist fight break out between two men who came up who wanted that. Now, I got to ask you if you're going to do this before I give you this. This is just not a freebie.
Oh, it's not.
Huh? Are you married?
I am married.
Are you married? Okay, yeah. This is a daily devotional.
I'm married to my newlywed, Kuntron. She's a beautiful girl right there.
All right. You hold his feet to the fire. This is a daily devotional. I want to know in a year how he did, okay? It's called Moments Together for Couples. I need to know if there is a professor here who is romantically challenged. They're not stepping up for this. Isn't this interesting? This is a romantic bunch you got. Is there a professor that would like tips to romance your wife?
Hey. Yeah.
All right. There's also a bonus one in there, tips to romancing your husband. See, so you stepping up may pay off. I would like to know if there's a fifth-year seminary student who really needs help in romancing your spouse. Barbara and I wrote a book called Rekindling the Romance. All right, I'm just going to lay this right here. Is any student interested who's married in staying close? This is the Weekend to Remember in print. We've held these for 38 years, had over 3 million people go through these conferences. You snooze, you lose. Is there a newly married couple who would like to start your marriage right? This is 52 readings. Here's a man who wants to start his marriage right. 52. You do it, okay? I wrote my thesis on this when I graduated from Dallas. I wrote it about building your child's self-esteem. It's when the word self-esteem was more in vogue than it is now, but turned into a book that sold over 500,000 copies called Building Your Mate's Self-Esteem, and it's a biblical approach. Wow! I love it! Are we going to have something to tell the board at the next board meeting? I really have two sets of these. One set for a couple who are engaged, who would like to go through what I believe is the best marriage preparation in print that's been put together. This is the number one seller in the category. It's been out for about 10 years. We took 5 years to create. It's called Preparing for Marriage. And I've got two different groups. One who's taking somebody who they're maybe counseling and they're going to marry them. That's this one with a leader's guide. You need to get another one for the other spouse. And then is there anybody engaged who'd like this one? Okay, I'll leave that right here. If some of you guys are thinking about proposing but didn't want to declare it here first, you might want to come in here in stealth and get that one. Just a couple more. Yesterday I talked about praying with your spouse every day. And I met a guy down here who 10 years ago started doing it. And he gave me two thumbs up. Has it made a difference? I'm looking at his wife now. It has. She's got a big grin. Wrote a little book called Two Hearts Praying as One. And it's just a real simple way. There you go. Good. A real simple way to begin the spiritual discipline. I got two more left. This is a book for men. This is a book for men called Stepping Up. Okay, you can't move on this one until I finish telling you what it is. And I'm going to go over here and stand. About 8 years ago, in the middle of the recession, we decided to invest about $1 million in creating a kit that could be put in the hands of pastors and laymen to reach out around the greatest felt need in our country, marriage and family. And we commissioned one of our staff to do it and created a six-hour video conference. This kit sells for $200, and if you get it, you'll have to also order manuals for those who go through it. This is not a talking head. This doesn't feature me. It has about 15 different men and women leaders teaching the scriptures, talking about it in the way this generation wants to receive it. Storytelling, vignettes, edgy, fresh, six sessions dealing everything from the purpose of marriage to communication to conflict to sex. And if you take it, you're committing yourself to do it with a group. Yeah, it helped to be up on the front row, didn't it? Well, this is going to be a heavy message, ultimately. It doesn't start out that way. But I want to talk about the terrorism of the soul. The assault on your soul by the world, the flesh, and the devil. Sometimes it comes from the most unusual people. Mark does not know this story. I don't think I've told Mark this story, but a number of years ago, Mark asked me to come and speak at a fundraiser for the seminary. I love to raise money. I think it's a privilege to ask people to give what they're going to regenerate multiple times in their lifetime and send it on ahead, okay? So when he asked me, I squeezed it in my schedule and said, I'll do it. And I was right between a guy, as I recall, from Texas A&M who has a Bible study down there of 5,000 people in the arena, who's a graduate of the seminary, and a young lady who I think she may have been from the Philippines or somewhere in Asia. And I had a 15-minute little window to tell them what God had been doing. Give them a little idea of what God had done through family life and just the value of the seminary to me as a young man starting my ministry. Immediately after finishing, I walked out into the audience. This is exactly the way it happened. I walked out, and three very attractive women from Highland Park surrounded me. And I kid you not, this is what happened. They said, "We heard you were a really good kisser." Now, it's the intensity of having spoken about what God is doing in a ministry, and you're approached by three attractive middle-aged women who walk up and just declare something that really has nothing to do with why I'm here and what I'm about. And I said, excuse me? It was a loud audience. There were 600-700 people at the Galleria. You remember this? I said, excuse me, what'd you say? We heard you were a really good kisser. And I'm going, I'm sorry, you're going to have to unpack what you're talking about here. I don't know what you're talking about. They said, well, we know this friend who's married to so-and-so, and her name, I'm going to call her Sharon. Sharon said that when you were in junior college together, that you took her out and you were really a good kisser. And I went, two thoughts went through my mind. Number one, I don't remember kissing Sharon, which was interesting. And number two, I was glad that the only woman I have kissed in 42 and a half years is one woman, my wife. And I was thinking, if I was not clean, if I was living a lie, I might have died of a heart attack at that moment. Sometimes they're kind of funny like that. Sometimes they're not so funny. I was in Kansas City speaking at a Weekend to Remember. These were back in the early days of our ministry when we couldn't afford for our wives to go speak at the conference. So the men would go and we'd speak about the wife's role in marriage. It was one of the real high points of the weekend for those people. We quickly raised the money so the wives could go. Feedback won the day. It was Saturday night. We'd been out to eat as a team, and I'd gone back to my room. It was about 10 o'clock. I remember I just thought, you know what? I'm going to click on the TV. And the Ten Commandments was on. And I just left it on, and my phone rang. I'd already talked to Barbara. And talked about her day and how the kids were doing. This was in the early 80s. I think we had four children at the time. And it was a woman's voice on the other end. It wasn't Barbara. The woman said, "Hey, how you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm doing fine. Can I come up?" I said, "Excuse me?" She said, "Can I come up?" I said, "Well, I don't think that'd be a very good idea." She said, "Why?" I said, "Well, two reasons. Number one, I'm happily married to a woman who is a magnet. She is a magnificent, godly woman who draws me from all over the country. And number two, I'm watching the Ten Commandments." True story. Here in Dallas, years ago, I told a story. I was here in the hotel with Barbara. The phone rings. It's a woman's voice who says, "Can I come up?" I said, "I don't think that'd be a good idea. Goodbye." The next day at the conference, Sunday morning, this woman comes up, and I'm on the podium, and she kind of comes up kind of giddy and giggling, and she said, "That was me last night that called you." And she turns around, points back to her husband. "My husband put me up to this to see if you were the real deal." Terrorism. We were invaded in 9/11. You and I are invaded daily in this culture. Someone has said sin would have fewer takers if its consequences occurred immediately. Ephesians 6, 1 John 2 reminds us that our souls are under the daily assault by these terrorists, the unseen forces of the world, the flesh, and the devil. In fact, I walked in to Bob Lapine's office one day. He's a co-host of our broadcast. And I said, Bob, I wish I had glasses that would help me spot when I'm battling the world, when I'm battling the devil, or when it's my own flesh, so I could spot it. Well, I do have the Holy Spirit, and He does help us. Paul warns in 1 Corinthians 9:24 through 27 that after I have preached to others, I might be disqualified. That's why he buffeted his flesh. That's why he disciplined his choices. Over the past 11 years, I have been a mentor to a couple of guys in the pastorate. There has been one subject that has dominated our monthly phone conversations. It's the same issue that dominated our date nights as we were raising our children. Barbara and I would go out for a date on Sunday night, and it started out to be a romantic date. But it ended up being the president and the vice president of the Rainey family getting together and pulling out our schedules and looking at how we were going to manage this thing called ministry, life, family, marriage. I do not know of another subject that caused more conflict in my marriage than those date nights, battling out the priorities of this little fledgling family that was starting. This is one of the unseen battles that can take you and me out of the race. It's not nearly as sexy as some of the others. It's a private one. It is the relentless pace of life and making choices that represent this book. Ephesians 5:15 exhorts us, look carefully. Look carefully how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Deadlines, emergencies, overcommitments, pressure, all relentlessly create a fatigue that can leave us vulnerable to the other traps. You with me? I'm going to quickly go through the wisdom of 45 years in ministry of battling this assault. I would encourage you to write these down. Number one, pray for and seek God for wisdom. James 1, 2 through 8 commands us to ask God for wisdom when we face various trials. We'll talk about that tomorrow again. But wisdom is godly skill in everyday living. You know where I learned that? Israel. I paid $399 and went to Israel with Bruce Walke. Some of the professors know him. Bruce taught Old Testament, and it was one of the most fierce courses to pass out of anything here at Dallas Seminary. And as we were going through the land of Israel, he was quoting from his photographic memory, translating from Aramaic to some other language to English, and spouting off all these things. And finally, by the end of the trip, I'm just a country boy from Southwest Missouri. And I was impressed at this professor. And I said, Dr. Walke, what is it like to be a genius? I said, these Arab guys are threatened by you because you know more about their country than they do. And they lived here and they grew up here. They're professionals. And this absolutely transformed my decision making. He said, ah, Dennis, back at the seminary, knowledge divides, but wisdom edifies. He said, as professors, we're battling this knowledge deal, and it becomes an ego deal, and it can divide us. But wisdom, he said, is skill in everyday living, godly skill in everyday living. So to handle this terrorist attack, you've got to have wisdom from on high, godly skill, godly application from the scripture, abiding in Christ, abiding in the word, walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. And you can't drop your armor for a moment. Secondly, listen carefully to your spouse if you're married, or have a couple of best friends if you're single that you can bounce ideas off. Get some alignment. Barbara, for me, is a gift from God. She's a woman. And 42 years of marriage has taught me she's different. Really different. Different isn't wrong, it's just different. But in the differences is the gift. She processes change differently than I do. She's slower, I'm faster. She adds different perspectives, different values more than once. She saw things that I didn't, sees things that I don't. And as her husband, I must value, embrace, and listen. Listen. Listen to her counsel. Next point, because I have a tendency to overschedule and say yes to too many things, Barbara and I instituted a boundary to protect me from me. Anybody else suffer from that in here? Type A personalities? I don't make, here's the boundary, I don't make a commitment or take a speaking engagement without first talking to Barbara. I'm going to tell you, there was a time there where if you could get me on the phone, you got me. Why? Because I'm in the ministry to help people. How am I going to turn my back on a need? But I've found it is tremendously liberating to say, you know, let me talk to my wife about that first. And then we'd have a date. We'd argue about it. Here's one that has really been good. Take an annual inventory that monitors your commitments. Look back over your calendar from the past 12 months, take a year at a time, and total up the number of days you traveled, number of days you were away from your kids, away from your spouse, number of nights gone during the week, and take a look at it. It's revealing. And then take a look at the year you have in front of you. Total up the number of days traveling, number of days away from the kids, number of days away from each other, number of nights gone each week. What are your commitments as you start this year? If you leave no margin, you are setting yourself up to fail where it matters most. In your private life and in your marriage and family. And if you're married, determine together your margins that you need to set together and your limits as a family. Resist the temptation to schedule to the edge, to the brink. Next point, learn the power of the word no. Say no to something every day, even if it's a tree. Just walk up to it and say no. Just to stay in practice. Listen to me. Too many women and men find that their success in ministry can be the demise of their ministry. Because once you build it, then you got to feed it. You determine you've outpunted your coverage. Final point, schedule defensively. Determine together what seasons or months during the year are most difficult for you as a single person, as a married person, as a family, and begin to protect those months in advance. For us, 2 months were the worst. What do you think they were, raising a family? December and May. We found if we could protect those, it could build an island of clarity. One reminder here, to say that you don't have time is not really a statement of fact. It's a statement of value, of what you want to invest in. Trap number two, and you're going to have to listen faster. Trap number two occurred early in my ministry. I had gone to the Billy Graham School of Writing for good reason. The only spanking I ever received in public school was in the eighth grade from my English teacher, and I deserved it. Viva Blancett and I were acting up on the back row, just kind of bantering with each other, and she pulled both of us, Mrs. Ladd did, up to the front of the class, turned us over, and broke a ruler over both of our behinds. So I really have had a thing about English ever since then. And so when I realized I needed to write, I needed to go find out how to do it. I went to Billy Graham School of Writing, and while there, I stayed at a Holiday Inn that had the slowest hotel in the world. You know, it's one of those you push the button, and you can hear it grinding its way all the way up to the top. So I decided, being on the third floor, I would just take the stairwell. Open the stairwell door, and there on the step, before I head down the stairs, was a rattlesnake. Figuratively speaking. It was a Playboy magazine, I assume. Center spread, right there, facing me. I'm amazed at how many things you can think in that moment. Number one, wow, that's a beautiful creature. Number two, no one will know. I can stick it in my briefcase. Number three, God will know. And number four, I'll have to tell Barbara. And so I stepped over it, went down the stairs, went to the classes, came back that day, pushed the button, had forgotten about the rattlesnake at the top of the stairs. Honest, I really had. Maybe I was a little weary, I don't know. But I decided, you know, that thing is taking forever. So I went up steps. Guess what was still there? 9 hours later, the rattler wanting to strike. Who knows what was at stake at that point? It was a choice. Psalm 101 is a great passage that has helped keep me and helped me in my journey to holiness. 101 verse 1 through 4, I will sing of the steadfast love and justice to you, O Lord. I will make music. I will ponder the way that is blameless. Oh, when will you come to me? I will walk with integrity of heart within my house. I will not set before my eyes anything that is worthless. I hate the work of those who fall away. It shall not cling to me. A perverse heart shall be far from me. I will know nothing of evil. What a great exhortation. C.H. Spurgeon, when speaking of evil, said, "Of the two evils, choose neither." I want to show you what evil does to a marriage. This is a pastor from Oklahoma City. This is from the Stepping Up video series that we've done in an effort to challenge men to step up and step away from pornography. Watch this story.
Even as a young kid, there was always access. Found a magazine under my dad's bed, and I hated myself. But the moment I saw it, heart starts beating fast, overwhelmed with curiosity. That's where the struggle, that's where it started. Because I didn't have a relationship with the Lord, it made it very easy for me to feed this new thing. I was a sophomore, I was 19 years old, started college pretty early, and a girl invited me to Campus Crusade. They were trying to, you know, reach me for Jesus, and it just started to come together. I would love to say that everything changed.
He had crooked teeth and he did not dress well, so that really wasn't it. What are you gonna do after college? And he said, thinking about going to seminary. That was like the moment that I thought, okay, I got it. Something's gonna happen here. I really like him.
Marriage is one of those crazy things that you have all these ideals of what it's supposed to be like.
You know, the first year was dreadful.
Wow, is it gonna be this hard? It becomes very easy to then go look at magazines.
I do remember a couple of occasions where I came home from work or something, and I would walk in and there was an image there that he couldn't get off the screen fast enough.
So it went from looking at images to chatting, having an interaction with this girl, and she said, "You want to meet?" I will never forget driving home. I had broken my promise. I can never go back and say that I kept my vow. I hated myself. I hated what I was doing to the name of Christ. And that led to about a 2.5 year period of time where I was physically unfaithful to my wife.
I just assumed that my husband, my worship leader, youth pastor husband, was walking and in full integrity.
A lot of my walk with God was a show. I met Craig Rochelle, who's the senior pastor at Life Church. A year later, he calls me up. The idea of moving to Oklahoma City, not appealing at all. But I legitimately thought that this was God's do-over for me. I'm sitting in a staff meeting, and Craig made a statement. He said, our private lives are what give us the opportunity to minister publicly.
That Tuesday morning, February the 19th, 2002, the door opens, like 9:30 in the morning, and I come around the corner, and he says,
"Honey, we've got to talk."
He just starts telling me the most awful things you can ever imagine hearing from your spouse. 1 minute I'm unpacking boxes, and 60 seconds later I'm wanting to die.
I felt that at the time. There's no other way than to get completely honest.
He looked at me and he said, "I know you'll never trust me again." He said, "But if you'll let me, I'll spend the rest of my life trying to earn it back." And that was 10 years ago. Nothing is off limits for me. His life is an open book, and thankfully because of that, God has allowed me to have trust in a man again that I never thought I would.
I am, to this day, completely free. I am not fixed, but I am not the same guy. God has set me free.
Quite a story. He confessed his sin in front of the whole church, lost his job, kept going to church there. They took away every screen that he had, got him a job at Home Depot. I believe it was two and a half, three years later, he was rehired to minister as a picture of redemption and God's grace. Promise Keepers found that 60% of all men and a third of the pastors had seen pornography in the last 30 days. That was back then. Today, the numbers are catastrophic. If you have a boy, a grandson, it is not a matter of if your son has seen pornography, and I might add, your daughter. It's a matter of when they will see it and how much. I had a friend who called me, whose 12-year-old daughter. He and his wife were doing a great job with her. Good boundaries, healthy home, good conversation, all the good sex ed and prep for adolescence. Gone to a friend's house. Friend pulled out a phone who had access that she didn't. Exposed to pornography in an instant. This screen generation is robbing our sons and daughters, men and women, of their innocence. The age now of a boy seeing porn is between the ages of 8 and 10. I was 20. Then there's the increasing number of women who are into romance novels. If you didn't see it a year ago, Wall Street Journal had a full-page ad on Valentine's Day a year ago for what is coming this Valentine's. The first of a trilogy, 50 Shades of Grey. Bill O'Reilly made $28 million last year. In 2013, $28 million on the sales of his book. Suzanne Collins, The Hunger Games, made $55 million, but author E.L. James topped the Forbes richest author list for selling 95 million worth of books and movie rights. And it's your sons and daughters, your grandsons and daughters, who are going to find themselves sitting in a movie theater, watching it, ambushed by the terrorist. If you have time, February 2 and 3 at 6 a.m. in the morning, I know you would be delighted to turn on your radios then. We will be featuring a broadcast with Dana Gresh and Julie Slattery calling Pulling Back the Shades on our radio show, which is heard on 100.7 FM at 6 a.m. in the morning, February 2nd and 3rd. You can go online anytime after that point on our website, familylifetoday.com, and listen to those broadcasts. You ought to listen to it because you're going to be working with people who are reading this stuff. Now, you need to know at this point in my message, which, by the way, just so Bill doesn't have a coronary here, I'm not finishing my message today. I'm going to finish it tomorrow. But at this point in this message, I really thought about asking who in this room has been exposed to pornography. If I ask that question and ask everybody to stand, what do you think would happen? Everybody. So what do you do? The terrorist has attacked. Some of us are carrying some heavy baggage. You can't keep carrying it into ministry and bring it into your marriage and your ministry and think you're going to be able to carry it for the next 20 years. Had too many interviews on our radio show of how guys who were exposed when they're boys in the pickup with their dad to a Playboy magazine. And by the way, there is a reason why that magazine is entitled Playboy. It's not being the man. It is playing the boy. But they get that magazine when they're 10, 11, 12, two decades ago. They get hooked. They become a believer. They bring the bags into the marriage relationship thinking that somehow marriage is some kind of institution, a rehab institution, that sex and marriage is going to redeem us from all that. And I'm sorry to tell you, it's not going to happen. It's got to come from the inside out. What do you do? Number one, it is only a continued experience of the fear of God and the love of God that can turn our hearts away from evil. It is not the fist of God that you're afraid of just by itself, although we need to be afraid of that. It is the grace of God, the love of God that invites us away from it. You know what's going on in your life. We all have issues that we struggle with. Personally, I think we need some fresh teaching, coupling both the love of God and the fear of God together to raise the standard of who God is. Why? A.W. Tozier said it best. I said it at graduation a couple of years ago. What you think about God is the most important thing about you. Why? Because as we think about God, it reorders our identity, who we are, and who we're accountable to. Number two, know your weaknesses. And as you know your weaknesses, counsel your soul. If you and I went to dinner tonight in a section of Dallas and we got mugged, we got robbed, would you like to join me again tomorrow night to go there? Would you go to the same section of the town and keep getting mugged? No. In fact, it reminds me of a great quote by the English preacher D. Martin Lloyd-Jones. Listen carefully to this. It talks about counseling your soul. This is a great statement. Most of your unhappiness in life is due to the fact that you're listening to yourself instead of talking to yourself. I think Lewis Sperry Schaefer would really like this next statement. The main art in the matter of spiritual living is to know how to handle yourself. You have to take yourself in hand. You have to address yourself, question yourself. You must say to your soul, "Hope thou in God," instead of muttering in this depressed, unhappy way. And then you must go on to remind yourself of God, who God is, and what God is, and what God has done, and what God has pledged Himself to do. Lewis Sperry Schaefer is really the reason for Spiritual Life Week here at Dallas Seminary. He believed all of this was about forming character. Third, know that as a single man or as a married man, solo sex siphons off energy and a drive that God gave you to pursue the opposite sex. Did you hear me? I'll say it again. Know that as a single man or a married man, solo sex siphons off energy and a drive that God gave you for good that causes you to pursue the opposite sex. We have the oldest average age in our nation's history for men and women getting married. 29 for men, 27 and a half for women. I believe this subject is one of the primary reasons why men don't need women, because they found a fantasy. Pornography and solo sex makes a man lazy. As a single man, you'll need no woman because you found a solution that isn't nearly as risky as relating to a real woman. And I got to tell you, after 42 years of marriage, a woman is dangerous. She is a delight. But it is one of God's great sanctifying tools in your life if you receive the gift. For married men, there's a new kind of marriage emerging called the low sex, no sex marriage. Can basically be the same escape that a single man makes. I've already said this one. Fourth, the bad news is, if you build an addiction now, marriage may be an institution, but it is no place for rehab. It's why, as I have given three of my four daughters away in marriage, one of the things I have done is talk to the young men who have come to ask for my daughter's hand in marriage. They'll come ask, and if it's all okay, I say, "Well, you know what? You can't have the hand yet. That comes on the wedding day. But you can ask her to marry you, and you and I have got six conversations to have before you get the hand and the rest of her." And one of those conversations is about sex, and it's about pornography. And how much have you seen? Let's talk about it. Why? Why would you invest your life in this princess, this beautiful woman, to stand before a pastor and pay a bunch of bills and write a bunch of checks and just say, "Her mother and I do"? I believe daddies need to be the protectors of their daughters and their sons. We'll talk about that Friday. Fifth, Genesis 2:25 says, "And the man and his wife were both naked, and they were not ashamed." That's the transparency of marriage. Let your wife know when you are struggling with temptation. There was a magazine article written in a book that, actually a journal called Leadership Journal by CT, 1981. It's like a prehistoric fossil. But it was an anonymous article. Some of the professors probably remember it. It was an anonymous article about lust from a Christian leader. The anatomy of lust. This may shock you, but I talk to my wife about lust I tell her when I'm struggling. I'm 67 years old, but I'm not dead. Some of you say, my wife couldn't handle that. Well, you know what? Then talk about that before you talk about the other. Because you're burden bearers. You're transparent and you're not ashamed. No fear. What a relief that is to be loved like that. Sixth, build a fence at the top of the cliff rather than run an ambulance service at the bottom of it. If you can't handle it, don't subscribe to cable. Get some accountability software. Better yet, get a friend you can call when you're tempted, especially if you're single. Personally, after being burned a couple of times, I can't channel surf. Hotel rooms, amazing. What's on TV? 7, if you fail, it's all about grace. Find a safe person, come clean before God and that person, but don't hide. The young lady who prayed you would not be isolated, and I said amen over there. Don't hide. Give. Share what you have been struggling with. Share what you have done with a person who can help you get out of jail, who can help you come free. Find a person who'll speak the truth with grace to you and give that person access to your life. This may not be the area where you're being assaulted. There may be some area, the same principle applies to that. I had a conversation with a guy who is an accountability partner in my life. Pastor, I've known him for a number of years, and I was upset about something. I was angry, and I wanted to wring someone's neck. Some ungodly anger. So I went and had lunch with him. We broke bread and had a barbecue sandwich. He looked me in the eye and kind of patted me on the shoulder and gave me wisdom from the book. You with me? So I saw him next week at church and I said, I hope I get the chance to kick your tail like you kicked mine someday. I got 3 more points. You'll have to come back tomorrow for them. Let me pray for you. Oh, Father, thank you for the cross. Thank you for redemption. I thank you that you know everything about us. You see where we struggle. Thank you for your love that just keeps pursuing us. I pray for these, my brothers and sisters in Christ, that you'd help them break free from isolation. Give the enemy no quarter in their lives for things in the past. Whether it be pornography, an emotional affair, sexual affair, premarital sex. I don't know what the accuser is accusing them of, but I pray that you would help them not listen to the accuser, but listen to you. Give us wisdom, I pray, as we live out our lives in an age that is indeed challenging. For your purposes and your glory, we ask it. Amen.